Welcome to my home. Yeah, we already killed a great workout. Branch did shoulders and MJ just made me wet. If I look really messed up, that's his fault.
And for the record, I want to say that me and Dennis did the legs together.
Yes.
Just so we know what we did.
I'm gonna remember that for a long time. Yeah, it's the same in life, right? Like my parachute jump.
Yeah.
Fuck, after that, I'm fearless. So yeah. Let's go and jump again. Yeah. You know? You don't
stop, rock the rhythm, that'll make you... And Vegas is a little bit like a lot of dreams here, you know? Of course, everything is excess. Everything is the craziest of the craziest.
That's it. We'll come back around when we're all done and we do single leg just to torture ourselves.
You hear that all the time, but it's so true. Don't let anyone tell you cannot do anything. You can do whatever the freak you want. Anyone tell you can't do it, tell them to fuck off. That's just being honest. I mean, you have to believe in yourself. You have to have the right people in your circle. And you gotta work fucking hard and be consistent.
Looking forward to be back here in the beginning of October and taking over the house again, and have a lot of people from all around the world coming to join us for the watch parties and maybe a cigar or two.
What you doing?
Sitting hello and keep your mouth shut.
I'm with Vegas heat in the lift factory, no air conditioning.
One more.
Metro flat style. She always gets on me. She's my...
He don't know how to shut up.
She's my mama.
It's like Nina Branch here yelling at me when I'm training.
He's moving the weight that Austin's moving with one arm.
Yeah, they're exaggerating a little bit, but it's great fun to feel a little bit the old school clinging of the weights, you know.
And just to give some context on the start of the trip, I was a steak at the Fridays at DFW.
Well, we kind of started off pretty lousy, so we had a first breakfast that, thank God, is Friday, which now was a Tuesday morning, and it sucked, and it was pretty bad. So getting the second breakfast in here in Vegas was just perfect and what we needed. So
yeah, so the Prepper Mill is one of those iconic restaurants here in Vegas. So I came here the first time in 2005. It was after Mr. Olympia competition. It was actually my first Mr. Olympia competition, me and Trish. And we came here, and I remember it was, 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning, because we went out that night and celebrated after Olympia. And so every trip I come to Vegas since then, and it's been a lot of trips, we always come to the Prepper Mill. And I've never had a bad meal here. You know, the steak and eggs is my personal favorite, but pancakes, plus the portions, you know, they're bodybuilder size portions, so that's always a good thing. You never leave here hungry.
We're pretty happy now, so we're ready to take on Vegas and go and check on our sites and stuff. Like, we got the house for the Olympia house, so we're gonna go and check out the premises. I'm here to see Brooke, so make sure that we have all the ducks in a row when we come in with the team, and we can do a lot of hospitality. You know, Branch always nags about how important it is that it's back in Vegas, and you know, he's right. There's a lot of reason why people from all around the world can travel to the same spot and have a good time together, because the environment is so diverse and there is so much things to do. It's a great destination for Olympia and for just about anybody who wants to experience something different and come to a little bit like a dream world that doesn't really exist, but it's here anyway. So great memories from 2 years ago. And now we're going to be back here soon again, so looking forward to be back here in the beginning of October and taking over the house again, and have a lot of people from all around the world coming to join us for the watch parties and maybe a cigar or two, and people from all around the world get together like this. It's like the highlight of the year for us.
Nah, so this is one of my favorite spots, man, so I always stay. I competed, I stayed at the Trump because we're in a casino there. It's quiet, got a kitchen, and then after the show, we come here to Capitol Grill, get a good dinner, and then it's a short little walk, we're gonna smoke some cigars on the strip. And then of course, the next morning, peppermint.
No, Milos is out there talking to me.
Leave it to Milos to talk his ear off in the parking lot in 105 degree weather.
And Brent is going to do some
legs.
Did you
work again?
I think.
He said he was asking legs.
Yeah.
I'm not joining that one.
What's up, you guys? We're back here on the channel. Last time I saw you guys, we was in New York, Beth Francis, Outlaw Gym as well, which we had a blast out there. And now we're in my hometown, in my neck of the woods, Las Vegas. We are currently 17 weeks out from the Mr. Olympia. Started prep last week. It's been already a journey so far. Coach already dropped the hammer on the food. So honestly, I'm already feeling the energy. Yeah, it's only been 1 week, but when you're eating so much calories in the surplus and you just take it away, you're going to be hungry. Energy is going to be low. You're going to feel the fatigue a little bit quicker. So, and that's bound to happen, but we've been progressing really well. I was 227 when I started prep. I'm 222 right now. But usually my weight, the water weight comes off quick, and usually the weight will plateau like at a certain middle ground weight, and then we'll just get leaner from there. So, but other than that, I feel great. I'm super excited to train legs and show you guys how we get down. I mean, the last time I did a leg day video for you guys was years ago, actually, in Texas. Maybe it was with Brett. That was probably 21. Wow. No, it was Metroflex. Metroflex Arlington with Martin when we trained legs. That was a long time ago. Wow.
Here we go. 12. Here we go.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
One more. Come on.
I did it. Again! One more!
Squeeze!
Down!
A lot of times in the past where I warmed up half-ass, and I had a half-ass training session. So when I warm up very well, I'm very prepared for the training like today, you know, with the bike, stretching, doing the bands for my knees. So had a damn great workout.
Three. One at a time, let's go.
Yeah!
Yep.
One! Yes!
Yep.
Two! Yes!
Three! One more! One more!
Yes!
Why he looks so freaky from the back. A lot of people confuse adductors on a bodybuilder for hamstrings because they create that line in the inner thigh from the back. But more so than like the freaky hamstring thing, I mean the hamstrings are just freaky. But the adductors just fill that gap. So when you look at a guy, you look at a guy with a back double bicep and he has no crack of, you know, sunshine between his legs, I mean, that's adductors. And it makes a world of difference on stage, a world of difference. If you don't have adductors and you're a male bodybuilder, get your shit together.
Three.
Overall, today was a great training session. I'm glad you guys to get to see the workout.
I had a damn good time. We killed it. I'm feeling it. Yeah, like I said, I'm 2 weeks in the diet, but like I said, when you're so high and you drop so low, your body and your metabolism, everything is like, what the heck? That's kind of how it was. And one thing about my physique, my body, it adapts very fast to anything I do when it comes to drugs, food, training. It adapts so fast. So, but this is what I signed up for. I love it.
Gifted physically, but mentally he's such a good athlete. When I saw him train late, I said, you know, you could use some more range in some of these movements, and he's like, okay, show me how. And it required him like stripping the weight down for like maybe a few weeks. He didn't care, no ego about it. He stripped the weight down, took the range all the way, and built back up from there. And this year it's crazy, he's so much stronger in that deep range. You're gonna see, he's gonna fill the whole stack up. Complete full range of motion, the tempo, all the reps look exactly the same. Chef's kiss. Chef's kiss!
Yes! Crazy. Come on, baby! Yeah!
I got used to it by now. I feel like I grew a lot. More like fullness and just like overall size of my legs with that. So, I like it.
So yeah, the Cybex is sort of like an overall leg developer. That's why they call it a squat press. Kind of mimics the pattern of like a squat. This one, adductors, quad sweeps, pretty much like everything in the front of the leg, but honestly, they both work all the muscles. Just depends on the angle you use, but we love this one. And sometimes it's not the strength, it's just the stamina. Yeah. So you'll come out of the gate and you're fucking killing the workout, and then all of a sudden the glycogen is like, nah. So you kind of hit a little bit of a wall, and yeah, and it's totally normal. So in those circumstances, I always tell people, you know, I do believe intensity is number one of importance. And so intensity can be met in different ways. If you want to maintain the same weights that you're using, you may be able to do that, but you may have to spread it in maybe another set. So maybe if, instead of doing a bunch of sets of 12, you maybe do or maybe if you're doing two sets of 12, maybe you do three sets of eight or six, you know, and still hitting that intensity, but maybe not going for as much volume per set. You require maybe a little more rest period between the two. So that's kind of what's happening right now. But usually Keon hits like a second wind after a few weeks of prep, and he ends up getting stronger. So check back with us in a few weeks. Breathe, brace down. Slow and steady all the way. There we go. Yep, tap in. Rest day tomorrow. Earn it. Let's go. Is to continue to grow, but to not lose his beautiful lines. He has what I always say is like Sean Roden like quads, beautiful, like detailed, deep separation.
I'm better than I was last year, and that's all that matters. Very confident in my ability of winning again, but you know, you guys gonna continue to see the work leading up to title number two. It's gonna be a good one.
So hey guys, we're here at a metro outside of Las Vegas, Nevada, with none other than the man who needs no introduction. IFBB Pro, Honorable Classic Champion, top three Mr. Olympia finalist multiple times, IFBB Pro Dennis Wolf. What's up, brother?
Good. Welcome to my home. I'm MJ Branch. I'm glad having you here, guys. We already killed a great workout. Branch did shoulders, and MJ just made me wet. You know, we did legs. So, guys, if I look really messed up, that's his fault.
That's good. Yeah, we had a great time.
Thank you for inviting us into your home and letting us train at your home gym. So you got a badass gym out there.
Yeah. Thank you.
And so really, really good equipment. So had a great, got a great pump, had a good workout. And I felt right at home because it's 10 o'clock in the morning and probably almost 100 degrees. So it reminds me of being home. So Dennis, man, I know I've talked to you. I know a little bit about your story, but I don't know how many of our people out there and how many of the fans out there know, you know Dennis Wolf. Everybody knows Dennis Wolf, the world champion bodybuilder. But, you know, tell us about it. I know you were born in Russia back in the 70s, and I know you eventually went to Germany, but tell me about your family, how your upbringing, your environment, how that affected you as a man, and how it affected your course becoming a bodybuilder.
For me, I've been telling the story many times, but still I think the new generation still don't know exactly where I'm from, and if they see me traveling to Russia or speaking Russian language or posting, you know, something with the Russian music, you know, at the background, they like start asking questions like, why this dude speaks Russian? So, yeah, I was born in 1978 in Soviet Union, you know, so, and I was growing up in the area of Kyrgyzstan, so Kyrgyz Soviet Republic. So back then in the Soviet Union, there were 15 republics. So and then after the Soviet Union kind of start functioning, you know, in 1990, so a lot of or most of these republics
became independent.
Declared independence, yeah. You know, like Ukraine, you know, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, so and but in 1990 we moved already to Russia, so to my grandma. My mother's side, so just to so you guys understand, my mom's side is German and my dad's side is Russian. So my dad is Russian, my mom is German, right? So the first thing was only the Germans, like full Germans, like with real German name, like, you know, real German blood, were allowed to come back. Later on, like 2 years later, they allowed to, you know, all the Germans who were already mixed, like part Russian, part German, like me. My dad was Russian, my mom German. So those families were also allowed to move back to Germany, right? So yeah, that was it. So in 1992, we moved to Russia and then we moved to Germany. And there was a very difficult time for me because no language, no nothing. And I used to play basketball before and all of that. So there was a stop for me. So there was no, I mean, there were opportunities to join any clubs, right, to start training, but with the issue ahead, language, you know, like different culture, that was very, very difficult. So after 2 years, I decided to start, you know, joining the clubs, like, you know, fighting sports, you know, tried a lot. And then, I think 1997, I went to the gym. So I joined the gym, and yeah, that was it. So I started liking it. I never felt something like that before, like that pump, you know, coming into your muscle. Mm-hmm. So before that, anything what I did before connecting to the sport, it was just exhausting. I was like, you know, pretty down after that, you know. So there was no good feeling like pump. So yeah, yeah, so that was basically it. That's how I got into bodybuilding. But prior to that, of course, I've been watching all the Hollywood movies, starting with Arnold, as probably everybody at that time, Sylvester Stallone, and of course, Jean-Claude Van Damme. You know, these three were my favorites. Also Dolph Lundgren. I even had a haircut when I was 15 from, you know, the Drago.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so, yeah, I was basically...
Swedish
yes.
Guy. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, is it true that his name is like, not Dolph, is like Johannes or something like that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So there's like translated, right? Dolph is
he's,
not...
yeah, he's, he goes by the name Dolph.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah.
But I was like reading his story back then, yeah. And so I remember yeah. that. He's yeah. Good. So that was my motivation to start that, and then as I was connected to, you know, weightlifting, and I'm, you know, kind of feeling the pump, that was it. And basically a year after I joined the gym, some guys came up to me and was like, hey, are you in prep for some show? I was like, what are you talking about? So I had no idea, right? So
you didn't know what you had.
No. So then one of these guys, Mike Schultz, He came again to me the same day and said, like, yeah, look, you have great potential.
Mike Schultz,
you know, so
was a bodybuilder, right?
Mike Schultz, yeah, he was a bodybuilder.
Yeah,
so he was like, do you think you can, you know, you want to do that? It's like, can you explain, you know, so what do you mean? So, and after that, back then, you had to compete over a gym. The gym must be a member in the federation, so that's how it worked back then in Germany.
Like,
so
how it worked
yeah,
in Sweden also,
right? Yeah. So, and then I had to find another gym.
So the gym had to be a member of the federation.
Yes,
you had to train at that gym to be eligible to compete.
Exactly.
I think it was a legacy from Ben Weider and how, you know, was trying to make bodybuilding ready for the Olympics and stuff.
Yes,
like that.
I guess so. I guess so.
I guess the part of the athlete federation in Sweden as an example, and that's. That's how you had to have the team. And
exactly. So you basically start looking for a gym, which one is a member in the federation. So, and then you will compete from the gym, like over the gym. But that was like 60 marks, like $30 back then, and they will pay for you, right? So, but if you want to do a like a membership for yourself, that was impossible, right? Mm-hmm. So, and then Mike Schultz took me to another gym, another city. That's where I met my wife later on, a couple of years later. So, and then, we got in a discussion with a guy. I said, like, okay, we started the prep. Just tell me what you eat, you know? So I'm like, what do you mean? I eat everything, you know? So, yeah, so then he explained me, you know, what to eat, how to eat, and what to do. And, basically, From that moment on, two months later, I was on stage.
So, but you said something when we were training legs earlier that in the beginning you didn't train legs because you didn't think about it or...
Yes, exactly. So when I started training in the gym, you know, I just did everything what I liked, right? So chest, back, you know, all that. But legs, like, sometimes or like a couple of months, nothing, you know, never touched the weights. And when, you know, I planned to compete, so that was like basically 2 months, 2.5 months. That's when I started training legs. So, and the balance was perfect, right? Of course, I was skinny, but the balance was perfect. A year later, exactly 1 year later, my legs overpowered already the upper body. So, yeah, the first show was okay. I didn't place well, so I was novice, did second, and then heavyweight was fourth. And a year later, the same show, I was the overall winner. So that's how big the jump was.
Yeah. Now, did you have back then, did you have a guru or a trainer or anything, or you just kind of just did it?
Look, but then you...
just when I was coming up, they wrote down on the back of an envelope, hey, eat this, 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 and this here.
Yeah, and, oh, not even that.
And that's what I did.
Yeah, exactly. So not even that much. So the guy who helped me would say, you eat that and that, right?
Was that still Mike Schultz or?
No. Mike Schultz, he told me, look, you just have to eat, you have to understand, you know, what is what, right? So, I mean, carbs down, protein up, you know, no fat, right? So that's like, if you're still carrying fat, there's no fat, you know, in your meals, right? Yeah. So until it's gone, then you start doing that. So that's how I started learning that. And the other guy, where I competed over his gym, he just told me what to take. There was like two probably, you know, supplements, right? That's it. So there was, you know, it was on. It was more simple back then than today. Today, if you're, like, I work with athletes, you know, and sometimes new clients, they send you some stuff, right? So what they've been doing, and you're like, oh shit, man, it's really, we did crazy, that, right? not even that much when we were pros.
Right.
So, yeah. So, since that, you know, I was thinking until today, the simpler the things are, the better they work, you know? So, and it's mostly that way. It's mostly.
I hope y'all heard what he just said. The simpler things are, the better they work. So y'all need to quit overthinking shit so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you won that show?
I won that show. So it was in 2000. And after that, I was like up and down. Met my wife, this and that. Was broke, you know. Like, you know, if you're young, some shit happens to you. Or you're not that careful with your life, maybe. Well, with your finances. Or if you're own some money, then you're not like, okay, I own it, not I don't own it to my friends or whatever, right? So if you own it to somebody, right? So you, back in days, I was thinking like that. So okay, they're not catching up to you. So I mean, so I'm free until that shit happens. That way where you have to take care of it, you know? So, but I think everyone, when he was young, has to go through that. That makes you stronger. That makes you more or gives you more responsibility and you understand life, you know. So, and after that, I competed in 2002 in another federation, took second, it was in France. And in 2004, I started kind of already taking everything more seriously. Competed again at the qualifier, did the overall, then German nationals. Got beaten by a guy who was really, I mean, not aesthetic, and that looked like he was shoot up with all that extra stuff, you know, what people assume we all take, right? Yeah. So I took a second. I was pissed, you know, wanted to compete in the other federation even, right? So I didn't do that. So in 2005, I won the overall again, got the qualification for the German nationals, won the overall, and I thought, finally, my dream come true, I get the bro card. No fucking way. They told me, you have to compete at the world championship. Excuse me.
Now, was that good enough? Sometimes, could you get a pro card after winning German nationals?
Yes, because before that, Marcus Ruhl got one.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Another good guys got the pro card after the, German winning the German nationals.
So they singled you out and won't let you have it.
Maybe it was a drive back in 85, 86, 87 to push for the world championship and do a pro card that way.
Yeah, so they told me I have to make like a top five and then we're going to apply for you, right, for the pro card. Because back then the federation has to apply here in the United States for the pro card for their athletes, right? So and they told me top five will be enough. But I think, if you're a great athlete, they want to show you around. You know, they want to take you to all international shows. I understand that. You know, it's federation. That's like they're always proud of the athletes, right? But I see it different, right? Yeah. So I want to move up. Yeah. I want to be a pro. That's my goal and the only goal, right? So and then we're flying in the same year, November, to China, Shanghai, and
what year was that?
That was in 2005. So, and I'm ending up winning the overall and beating all the world championships. Even like 2012, Mr. Olympia, Kamal Agagni, he was there in the overall fight. A lot of good guys. You remember Ali Tabrizi?
Oh, yes.
So, all of them. So, and, beat them all.
It was stacked.
So,
it was a good show.
Yeah. So, that was insane. And then I start to understand that later on, maybe like a month or two later, that that lineup was crazy. So any one of us could have been overall champion. You know, so at the end, I think that was the right thing to do, winning the overall world championships, because as a German champion, nobody will even know me or notice me, right? So, but the world champion is like going around. Yeah. So after that, I got the flex cover, bam, 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 bam. You know, so I think that was still right, to wait a little bit, put more money in it and time. And so that's how my pro career started. So in the 2006, Rupa Sopa Show in Dallas, that's where
I met you.
I started, I was like, I told Brent already, we were upstairs waiting for a meeting or something. I don't know. That was like, back then, that took a long time. You were waiting and waiting.
Yeah, drag it out.
Yeah, so, and I was sitting like, and then Brent walks in. And I was like, it's Brent. Then King Kamali walks in. I was like, look, King Kamali. They all looked like, I don't know, man. So back then, that was so exciting and like to see pros. Now look, I've been to America before, right? But seeing top pros and understand these are my rivals or soon to be rivals.
Because it's the guys that you followed in the magazines and everything, you saw them, and now it's like, now I'm gonna be like on stage with them competing.
Yeah, exactly, And then one thing is, hey, you're excited. Another thing, you can believe it, right? Mm. So it's a very mixed up feeling. Texas was great, and that was my year. In 2006 I did three shows.
How did the show go?
I placed seventh. I think Tony Freeman won.
I remember seeing him on stage. We're sitting there with Johnny. I think Johnny was sitting with next to me, and I said, man, that guy's gonna be good. And Johnny's like, yeah. And we were right. We're good for him, bad for me, but he turned out to be really good. So,
yeah,
I called that one from the beginning. So.
No, I mean, it's like even before I turned pro, a lot of photographers after the like small shows, which I won, they will come up to me and say, "Man, I don't understand that shit. Why did they just give it to you, man? Like all the pros in the last 2 years, like except Marcus and Günther, they were like smaller pros and." They're like, they're not even look like you and they're pros. It's like, hey, that's the rules. What can I do, Yeah, but you could see in the beginning already, like, I have a potential. But, we've seen so many guys with potential in our life.
Yeah.
And they mostly, like most guys with a lot of potential, too much potential, they end up, you know,
don't do nothing.
Nowhere, yeah. Doing nothing. Yeah,
it came too easy for him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, I, like my first show, there was a guy, he took the overall. He was like 2 years younger. He was junior. Mm. 2 years later, he was doing coke, doing this, doing that. You know what I mean? So, and yeah, he disappeared.
I've seen so many guys over the years. You see amateurs and pros. You look at these guys, man, this guy could be something. And right. and they fade out.
Right.
So.
Yeah, I don't know why, but yeah, that's life, you know? It's not always like that direction. The direction can be, you never life, find it back.
Life can take some unexpected turns.
Yes.
Yeah, and I
too
think,
many sometimes.
I think also like in development, you need those hurdles in order to hone yourself to be better. And those who can push through that, they come back stronger and they use the setback to overcome and be even better.
So many give up, you know, they just maybe find something better in life or easier, you know, so then they just do something else.
See, I think to be a pro bodybuilder, to be a top pro bodybuilder, you got to have something wrong with you.
Mm. Oh, definitely.
So, I mean, you got something wrong with your brain a little bit to choose this.
That's what I would say too. Yeah. I mean, how the hell can you be happy about that you're torturing yourself? Right, I mean, it's not fun. Like, can you go to someone and say like, yeah, let's go train and do legs, right?
For the next 10 years, you're gonna train every day till you almost get sick. Sometimes you will get sick.
Yeah,
you're gonna be so sore you forget bed in the morning. And you're gonna eat the same shit, chicken and rice, and maybe a little steak and potatoes every day, 6-7 times a day for 10 years. And you're gonna like it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yeah, but I think it's. It's out like you know we're not normal, I would say, but. We are so strong, you know, like doing all this stuff to our body and changing the body and seeing the change, seeing the development, seeing the progress, all of that. And of course, I mean, the struggle. How many, maybe we think the same. So you get up in the morning when we are competing, right? So it's like the beginning of your day, right? So, but at the end, of the day, if you're eating your last meal, what are you thinking? Thank God, man. Now I feel free, right? Yeah. So kind of, my job is done for today.
Done for the day.
Right, so then you have-
relax for a minute.
Yeah, then you have an hour or two, and then you go to bed. And the day starts again, you know, the new day. But the last meal, you're so freaking happy.
You had that sense of accomplishment.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
You had to get up, you had to do cardio, you had to eat, you know, 6-7 meals a day. You went to the gym, you trained your ass off. And then when you got that last meal in, I was the same way. I was done. I was sitting there like, I'm done.
Yeah, so that's
it. I got this one. This today was success. I got it all done.
And the feeling, right? Yeah. So it's like, man, like a huge rock is just falling down.
But I like a little bit what this morning when we met outside before we went in and had a workout and we start talking about your parachute, you know, thing and how you said that after that, you know, everything else went so much easier. And I think when I hear you talking about that, and then I'm thinking about leg workouts that you did in the past or, you know, whatever, like, you know, you had a little bit the same mentality that you're not afraid if you're gonna die under the leg press, you know, like you just did it.
Absolutely, yes, yeah. Absolutely. It's the same, you know, you're pushing yourself every time a little bit further.
Yeah.
You know, it's painful, like even you know, an hour ago,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I know it hurts. I know the legs won't push it further, you know, so you're still trying it, right? So that set was already like a mess for you, you know, you start feeling dizzy, but you still do the next one, right? So, and also if you have a great team around you, that's even better.
Yeah.
You don't want to look weak, you know, you know, show your friend or whatever, you know, you cannot do another 5 reps, you know, things like that. So, and after that, I don't know how it works, but you get
everything else goes easier,
smoother
the
next time, you know, because you've been through it, right? So, yeah, it's the same in life, right? Like my parachute jump.
Yeah.
Fuck, after that, I'm fearless. So, let's go and jump again. Yeah. You know,
and you're also referring to other stuff that you were doing, that you know, you do like a surgery or do something that you could be a little bit worried, but after the parachute is like yeah, what the hell,
let's exactly do it. Exactly. So you probably catch yourself that before that, like you know, just an example with my parachute jump. Before that, I was thinking more over the things, you know, like, oh, you know, what can happen, or oh man, it's a lot, you know. So so you know, like things like that. But after that, so even when we did the training, right? So I was in Russia. We did that. We were invited by the president of the parachute skydiving school and federation over there, and we answered like, yeah, fuck it, let's do it. Then the next morning we were on the way over there, and I was still okay, so I was not nervous, nothing. I don't know why, but basically you're already like thinking, man, you're gonna jump, right? So we came there, 2 hours training, easy, like all fun. And then he says, so if you jump out of the plane, it's 50-50 that your parachute will be
spinning.
It will be
twisted.
So, and I was like, shit, so what am I gonna do then? He's like, yeah, don't worry, you just turn yourself and then, you know, it's gonna be fine. He's like, hey, it's 50-50, so that make me more problems in my head first.
Like problems, yeah.
Right, so he's gonna twist it, like 50-50, so what? So, and then he's like, during the training, he said like, okay, that's the easiest thing, so it's gonna be 50-50, that's it's twisted, but another thing you have to be careful with is if the line is over the parachute. So if that happens, you have to, you know, get rid of the parachute and pull the next one, right? So I was like, shit. So that was already a problem for me in my head. Like, how can I recognize that? Is it just twisted or it's like, you know, completely, you know, with
the glass? So you're by yourself. When you jump by yourself?
By myself, yes. Yeah, it was 1,200 meters.
So it wasn't tandem, it was...
No, it was by myself. Oh, shit. Yes, yeah. That was...
Russia,
in Russia. Yeah, everybody's telling me since then, hey, it's impossible. Basically, you jump in tandem, right? Yeah, yeah. So. Another guy is like clicking you in and you jump, right? So, but they told me no, it's
I was supposed to do it this year in January, long story, but I was helping a guy in does charity for the military and, you know, first responders, and they were going to jump over the pyramids, and he'd been promising to take me parachute jumping, and so anyway, he said, hey, got a surprise for you, you go with us, and your first jump's going to be over the pyramids in Egypt, but it's going to be a tandem jump. Uh-huh. And I said, well, man, don't I need some training or something? He's like, nah, man, it's easy. You just do what we do. I'm like, all right. But Trish was pregnant, and she was due like a few weeks later. So I was like, I better not, go overseas. But yeah, I wish I am going to do it. So,
hey, believe me, you know, doing that with 45, I wanted to do that like when I was 20, 25. But with 45, well, probably in the beginning, I was thinking, you're too old, man. But then it's like, hey, why not?
Why not?
We just leave once, you know? Yeah. So, yeah, it was after that, really, I landed. So that was like whole team. So the guy, he filmed me like training, going to the plane, sitting in the plane. So they opened the door and I was the first one to jump out. So before that, I was supposed to be the third, right? So, but they gave me that like sport parachute. It's a little bit smaller. So they wanted me to fly a little bit longer, you know, so and do a couple things, right? So
first jump,
sport parachute. So so as soon as they opened the door, I was like, oh shit! Even on the way up, I was like I was flying somewhere, right? So yeah, not nervous. Open the door, I was like, oh shit! So and then I'm standing next to the door and just wanna look outside, and the guy. Take the hand away, because you jump out just holding with the right hand. Yeah, yeah. So if you do that, so you probably injure yourself. So he's like kicking it back, right? So, and the guy is asking me, you ready? I was like, no. You're insane. Like, how can you be ready for that? He was like, shit. And I told myself, like, man, what am I doing? You know, so it was like, jump. It was like, fuck you. And I jumped out. So the guy would jump right behind me, would film me, you know, and even the guy who was standing, you know, down, he was filming me. So that was like whole production, you know, they sent me the video and all stuff. That was crazy. As soon as I landed, I really asked, like, hey, can we do that shit again?
Sure,
so
fun,
that
huh?
was so good, man, so good. So I think that the next day I will do that, but same day I will jump maybe two more times. Mm. And it was so much fun. It's incredible. Yeah, but after that, like, everything was so easy for me. Like, the same evening, I had a seminar for, 4 hours. I was standing 4 hours, so I was energized. From that morning, I jumped with a parachute. So, hey, crazy. So I couldn't believe it. So, and then I couldn't sleep until, like, I don't know, deep in the night, like 3, 4 a.m. So, you know.
That's
so,
cool.
Yeah, and then, 3 weeks later, I came to Germany from Russia, and I had an appointment for my surgery. We would drive, like, 6 hours from my place in Germany. So, six, 7 hours, we will arrive like at 6 a.m. over there, took a nap for an hour, went up, and I did the surgery, right? So I like just fill out all the paperwork because it's my friend. Yeah. So, and the guy like, okay, doing the anesthesia here, like, you know, connecting all this stuff, you know, like, and my surgeon said, hey, it's the shoulder side, so give him something to, you know,
relax
it and numb it.
Nerve block. I had it.
Yeah.
When I had my shoulder, they shot at my neck too.
Yeah. So, yeah, so it's like, okay. And I was like, fuck. And then, yeah, you know, anyways, you know, like I was not thinking too much over it. So like, he's like, okay, turn your head, lift it a little bit. Oh, you find it? Okay. Poof. So I didn't feel anything because I was like, you have to do it anyways, you know. I was like, fuck it. So I just I heard something like somebody poked me, poof, you know, but no pain or nothing. So I heard that sound.
Yeah.
That's it. I was like, oh, okay, I'm in, blah blah blah. So okay, now I'm putting it in. So then you feel like, oh, it's cold. So yeah, I was not afraid. Since that parachute jump, a lot in my head is different. Really, so maybe sometimes you have to do some crazy stuff to maybe wake you up or just understand it's only one life you live.
100%. I think when you do something like that, that's super high adrenaline and it's dangerous, it can change you. I think it'll definitely change you. So it'll make you open your eyes.
100%.
It's a little bit like a near-death experience where you're kind of like... where you feel like, you know, you get different perspectives on life and how important it is to live life to the fullest.
Right.
And have no regrets.
My wife did the night before the jump. She's like, send me all your passwords. Paperwork. All the passwords. Send me all the passwords from the crypto.
The life insurance is good, right?
Everybody's laughing.
Yeah.
No, yeah. That was so much fun just doing that. Like I said, like, you would say, oh, it's a simple thing, right? But, man, if you've done that, you understand how big or how can it change you in positive way. So I didn't change totally. So I'm not like going crazy and doing totally different stuff as before. But you think like your mental sharpness is different. You think different. You're kind of more enjoying things too. You know?
Yeah. But I think like for me, it's inspiring to hear you talking about that because I feel like a big part of Gasp and Better Body's philosophy is to say yes. Is to, you know, live life to the fullest and have that attitude of doing things and not be running in small circles.
Yeah.
And just be between, you know, your home, like the work and the gym and the home again in very small.
Right.
Like this, what you're talking about is kind of like really, you know, say fuck it to everything and just do it.
Yeah, and, you know, that's that's gonna work, you know. So a lot of people are afraid, you know, like, oh, something can happen. Yeah, hey, you can go out and
you're gonna run down to the gym.
Exactly, you know. So you like, how many young people died in the gym last 2 years? Just, you know, squatting.
How
and
many?
Then,
how many people live life but never really live?
Yeah, I think that's
most,
the that's,
most of the people.
Yeah, but so, that's the more scary part is actually those who are alive but they're not living, you know.
And you know, there are some people, they are not happy. Mm. And, but they do the thing, what they do every day, but they're not happy.
And they do nothing to change it.
I cannot live like this.
Not me either.
Never. Mm. Never. If I feel something is off, something's not working out, I'll rather change my life completely before I regret it in 10, 20 years. Than like, oh, when it's too late. Mm. If you're 60, you don't have to do shit anymore, right? Yeah. So. But still, you can do whatever you want, right?
That's right.
Even at 60. But like I said, it's like if you want to live your life, you should do that because we are not understand that every day is, it means less of your time, right? So, but nobody lives like that. The time is running out. Of course, it doesn't mean like you have to do whatever you can just to live. No, but you have to understand that there's a, I mean, sense in it, right? So if you want to have a good life, enjoy your life, you have to do something for it. But if you can't change anything, I mean, of course, then you should rethink everything and try something new. But like I said, I will never do something for a long time which is not working for me or doesn't make me happy. I will rather change my whole life and even go somewhere else, whatever, right? So whatever works for me, but I will never sit in the same place and just complain and do nothing.
So I'm gonna ask you a what if question. Had you not left Russia and went to Germany, do you think you'd have been Dennis Wolf the bodybuilder?
That's a good thing to ask because you will never know, right?
Correct.
You will never know. You will never know what if I, because every decision you make in your life, it's changing your life, right? So, but
did you have when you were growing up in Russia, did you have a goal or like, you know, some people when they're kids, they want to be an airline pilot or a fireman or something like that? Or did?
Yeah. I always wanted to be an NBA player.
Okay. NBA player.
NBA
okay.
player. So I was playing basketball when I was a kid. Yeah. Right, so a couple of years, and right before our first tournament, like competition, we moved to, like, from Kyrgyzstan to Russia. Mm-hmm. So, and then 2 years after that, we moved to Germany. So, in Russia, I was living in a village, so there were no sports, you know. So we will play. I mean, me and my brother, like, whatever, ice hockey in winter, you know, it's like two of us, whatever, right? Or some other kids. But it's you know, sometimes probably every one of us thinks over like, oh, what if I will do that back then, or if I would just start sooner or understand something sooner, you know, or better right in the beginning. So, but how I think about it, you cannot know like
no,
how much
know.
Or I mean, it might be, I will be probably in sports because I always loved sports, but who knows, maybe back then, I think in the 90s, there were like two Chechnya campaigns, you know, that was like special operations in Chechnya, mm-hmm. like I think middle of the 90s and end of the 90s.
It's two wars, right?
Yeah. So. Who knows? That will probably draw me into it. Who knows, right? So, because my one of my relatives, he was almost close to, you know, getting there, you know. So, but in the 90s it was very difficult time, and he kind of paid his doctor, so he like put something in it, so he's not, so like they cannot use him in the military, you know. So. But they were lucky because his dad was, they're farmers, so there were a lot of food and honey and stuff, so they just give it to the doctor and it was gone. So that were the 90s. So that's why if the Russians talk about difficult times, it's fucking really no joke. The 90s were freaking bad. So that's why so many people in the 90s immigrated to Germany, America, you know. So yeah, now it's, you can compare it. You can compare it. It's like, you know, Russia today is like everywhere else, right? So, but the media trying to put, you know, put it out like, oh, Russia is still people like suffering, nothing to eat. Believe me, there's more food you can imagine. I mean, there's like everything and everything, and everything is here. Yeah. So, I mean, like you drive, right? So you get the ticket for speeding. You can pay it right away. So if you pay it right away, 50% off.
Discount for
discount.
Paying soon.
Paying right away, right? So or paying it in the next 2 weeks, you get 50% discount. Or you're driving and there's like speed limit 50. And if you're driving with navigation,
can
right?
You,
so
can you pay in advance?
No.
Get some credit?
Maybe. So, and it's telling you, oh, camera is somewhere. So it means if a speed limit is 50, you can drive 70, right? So they give you some room, right? So you're
good.
Yeah, so a lot of things are, you know, for people, right? So, I mean, a lot of help too. So, I mean, you still get like a lot of things sent out in the mail and stuff, right? In Russia, it's all digital. Almost everything is digital. So, yeah, so they're a little bit different in that direction. But in overall, it's the same. It's just the same, you know? So,
but this is, I think this, you know, go to what we talked yesterday evening about, like, everything is way more complex than we often see or
yes,
hear. And, you know, it doesn't matter really what it is, what country it is, or, you know, what culture. Like, things are, you know, pretty similar like this. And then, of course, if you go and find, you know, different things that is on the left side or on the right side, is like, different.
Yeah.
But still, a lot of stuff is... It's very...
Yes, it's like, you know, in every country there are, like, people that live good, some people are poor, right?
Yeah.
So it's normal, it's everywhere, right? So, but nobody's talking about United States, that we have 30 million, you know, like, what is it, homeless people.
Mm.
Like, how the fuck is it possible, right? So,
yeah,
you know?
I don't get that, because we used to have no homeless people.
Exactly,
so,
right?
Yeah,
see?
So.
So, look at that. Fucking comparison, right? So yeah,
and it takes time also. I mean, I grew up in Sweden, you know, in the 70s, and you know, we got fed with a certain type of propaganda about Russia and China in the 70s and 80s, and those things live with us still, you know.
I know.
Some of it, you know, like the DNA of all that stuff. So it's very hard to change.
That's why,
you know, our perception, you know.
Like, media is so dangerous because they can put it in your mind and that's it. It's going to stay there forever. Like, I've been talking to judges back then when I was still competing. And I was in Russia. It was a show. And there were a couple judges from the U.S. And I was like, man, I can't believe... You know what I see in Russia, you know, because they remember that 80s, you know, like here in the schools, they will teach the kids, oh, Russians are bad. In Soviet Union, we had like a 1 hour a week preparation for atomic war, things like that. So what to do if that happens? Well, the 80s, I mean, there was like a Cold War.
We did the same thing here.
You see?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that was like normal back then, right? So, and then also look at the movies. Right, so American movies, look, it's always like in the 80s, always the bad guys, Russians. So then in the 90s, bad guys were Germans. So, you know, so then it's everywhere the same, you know. So, yeah, but it's kind of crazy to remember that, you know, what kind of life I lived, you know, moved from, you know, from and to many countries. It's insane. I think I'm ready to write a book.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. Then they should. What's the next chapter in Dennis Wolf's life?
Oh,
where do you go from here?
Oh man. Ah, guys, I can't tell much, but there's some big plans regarding myself, my life. That's gonna end. Oh, not that end. It's gonna change. It's gonna change.
Start a new chapter.
Yeah,
close one chapter and start a new one.
Yeah. So I think if I start doing it or if the time comes, a lot of people will talk about. But like I said, I cannot say much. Well, I'll keep you up to date, guys.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah.
Look forward to hearing about it.
We're curious to hear.
Yes. Yeah, me too. It's it's difficult. It's very difficult what I've been planning.
Yeah.
But it's doable.
Yeah. If it has something to do with parachute, I mean.
Okay.
Because I was excited about the story.
I figured here is a place in Vegas on the Strip. I think you can do that skydiving in the tube.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the next thing I'm gonna do.
I did that.
Good job.
It's 10:30 in the morning. It's probably 100 degrees outside, which we're used to that shit. So I love this open air heat. You warm up real quick, and since you're in the weights, baby, ain't nothing better. We don't need your sympathy.
Slow.
We wanted to make sure we had a place that we could entertain our friends, because when you live in Vegas, you always have visitors. It doesn't fail, like every month you have someone coming in town, and then obviously after the Olympia, because it's here, we were around the Olympia time, we want to be able to entertain our friends, our family, probably you guys, Patrick, Keon's coach. It was important to me particularly. I wanted a place where everybody would feel comfortable hanging out. And I like to cook.
It feels weird having the legends here. There's always the other way around.
Texas Pro.
Yeah. Oh, that's a nice sign.
Oh yeah. Olympia. Me and Arnold.
Yeah.
My favorite pitcher. New York Bro. That's my first time I met Sean Corbett in person. I was fanboying like crazy. Don't tell him I said that.
You're on video. Oh. Holy moly.
Yeah, man, it's just crazy to be talking to you guys in my new places. You're my new place. You guys actually seen it unfold from living in Atlanta, from driving, me and Hector drove all the way to Texas, which is like a 12, 13 hour drive from Atlanta to get signed. Well, I wanted to prove MJ that like, I'm that next guy. Like I can fit in, but not when you fit in, I can represent the company well and I can grow with you guys. And that's what we did. And so when I moved to Texas, you guys saw my little apartment there. And now we're here in Vegas where Mr. Olympia is at, which I am the reigning champion. I'm coming back for title number 2 this year, so let's make it happen. And life has been great. I've been such in a great routine staying in Vegas, not only with Olympia being here, but I'm around so many great competitors, bodybuilders, just great people that's here to push you. You know, I didn't see myself being here around these such a great influencing people here. But it happens and it feels great. I mean, it's so cool, man. Like when I walk in Dragon's Lair, people basically wait for me to get in the gym to turn the fuck up. Once they hear and feel my energy, everybody feels good. That's probably like the best compliment that I ever got in my 29 years of life. I literally had people come to the gym and would say, I didn't hear you holler today, you good? Or they'd be like, man, I heard you holler today in that last set. That made me push harder on my set. And that makes me feel great to know that people look at me that way, you know. So like, I feel like that I am the energy when I walk in the gym. And it feels great, especially at Dragons, you know. That's 7-time Mr. Olympia Flex Lewis gym. And it's crazy. It's just crazy. I mean, this right here is that's my motivation right there. And I plan on having another one this year. Yeah, such a surreal thing, but we're here. I mean, when I won, I wasn't shocked. I'm not going to say I'm shocked because I put the work in 110%. So being shocked is not even a word. It was, I guess it was more so, I just thought about everything that I went through to get here. All, you know, and I thought about all the doubt that I had, you know, me sitting at the Olympia in 2020, people telling me I was a waste of talent, waste of genetics, I shouldn't bodybuild anymore, I'm a crybaby, I'm a head case. I heard it all just from sitting out for my mental health. But me sitting out is what allowed me to do that win. And so, you know, that's everything I thought about when I won. But the doubt, I ignored the doubt the whole entire prep. I was locked in. I mean, I stopped watching bodybuilding YouTube. I unfollowed the bodybuilding accounts on Instagram because they like to do the comparison pictures. And I muted, honestly, I'm gonna be honest, I muted a lot of people on social media because I didn't want to see their stuff. For me, like, I got to do whatever it takes for Keon to feel good mentally, especially mentally and physically. And that's what I did. And everything paid off. I'm very blessed. I have Amanda, my girlfriend. I love you. And she helped me a lot and pushed me through every single thing, the ups and downs, the low days, the high days. She was there for me, so that helped. You know, having a partner next to you through it all, it's like the best thing a man can ask for. It was definitely one of the best feelings in the world, like by far the best feelings in the world, where they're saying, and new 212 Mr. Olympia, Keon Pearson. That was crazy. I watched that video all the time, till this day, because Not only because I won, but just, like I said, everything I went through to get to this one moment. It was pretty rough after Olympia. It was pretty rough. Probably won't go much in detail, but it was pretty rough. But we bounced back, and everything happened for a reason. All that happened for me to get here. And I'm very, very blessed, and I'm very grateful. Every single day I'm grateful for living this lifestyle and be able to keep you guys entertained with the cool lifting content. But not only that, you know, you guys can see myself, my lifestyle, and I hope this inspires you guys to know that you can do this too, no matter what. Forget what anyone say. Don't let no one say you can't do it. I know that's, we hear that all the time, but it's so, so true. Don't let anyone tell you you cannot do anything. You can do whatever the freak you want if you put your mind into it, have the right people in your corner, and first but not last. What else to say? What is it again? Last but not least, let's redo that one right there. You ready? Let me redo that one. But yeah, you guys, something I want to tell you guys, you can do anything you put your mind into it. Whether you want to be a professional golfer, swimmer, bodybuilder, whatever. Anyone tell you you can't do it, tell them to fuck off. That's just being honest. I mean, you have to believe in yourself. You have to have the right people in your circle. And you got to work fucking hard and be consistent. Just know that bad days will come. But you got to appreciate the good days. Appreciate the good days. And when the bad days come, I think it'd be a lot easier to handle those days. So stay consistent. And I hope this video inspires you guys. Because if you guys that's watching this and are still trying to, you know, work on that goal, I've been there. I've been there before and I know how it feels. Keep working. Keep striving. If this message is touching you, listen to me. Keep working. Keep striving. Have a good, honest circle behind your back. And I promise you, you can do it. Believe in yourself.
What's good about the Lift Factory?
Turn around. Show them.
Right here, baby.
You didn't come in to talk.
Either work out or stay at home.
When the line falls, what? Did I see a bad motherfucker standing next to me with his eyes closed?
I would put one back here with Branch right here. In the leg room, that's where it's known for legs, hardcore legs.
But so he's still the king. He's still the king. Trying to follow orders, just gone and be free.
This is the first gym I ever visited in Vegas. I've only lived here 6 months, but this is, you don't see gyms like this often, man. So you, when you do it, like even watching videos of him, like Metroflex, it seems it's the same type of culture.
Yeah.
Charlie is he's from Maryland. He's a Maryland boy. You could see about six foot, 270. He's a NPC competitor. He's done, I think, nothing but muscle contests. So he's just getting his feet wet. He just put on like 40 pounds in the off season. So his is his biggest frame he's been on. So with him, it's just getting him bigger and trying to get him filled out with that frame. Cause you know, being a super heavyweight, he's gonna have to be at least 250 on stage at his height. So he's doing my show coming up November 1st or 2nd. Steve Karr Las Vegas Classic, sponsored by Gasp. He's gonna be doing super heavies. And what do you think you're gonna be weighing?
Probably high 240s, high 240s.
What'd you weigh at your last show?
230 on the dot.
Wow, so 10, 15 pounds more muscle.
For sure.
Yeah, with him, his upper body's there. It's just, he's gotta bring the legs up. Opposite of me. I've always had big legs and I needed a bigger upper body. So one of those things, he's 26, so he's got time. So time is on his side. So we're gonna get him fucking huge.
Hell yeah.
3, 2,
yep. Let's go. Come on. Come on. Go. Come on. Come on, push it. Push it. Push it. Let's go. Come on, Oak. That's it. Right there. Half. Come on. Give me halves. Yep. Go. One more.
Good. Drop in place.
Be careful now. Careful now. Careful. I got you. I got you. Yeah. Go. Go. Go.
Viking. Got Viking heritage.
He's. What are you?
Danish.
Danish. The big boy Danish. Yeah.
Denmark.
Denmark.
We make sure that we have all the Vikings scattered.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and then we conquer the world.
Where's James?
Yeah, we have him here soon also.
That's it.
How was it here at the Lift Factory?
Yeah, that was awesome. Yeah. I really enjoyed it, and especially training with Austin and Charlie here was great. I liked it. You know, we did chest and we did triceps, and it was great to be, throwing some weights around with big guys like this. It was fun.
Just having fun with it. You know, I got here in the desert 6 months ago. We're talking about, so many people want to complain about the heat. It's really about being grateful for it and engulfing yourself in the environment. There's not many gyms like this. So every time I come here, it fills me up. And to be here with Michael, I'm just grateful. I'm grateful to be here.
Gratitude.
Yeah. And I'm grateful too, and I'm putting in my part of work so everybody else can feel a little bit the same. Like everybody's putting something on the table. You know, nobody's here for like a free ride or everybody here because we got fueled by putting something on the table and then can be able to eat from the table. That's how we do it in the Viking world.
Relentless. no excuses.
Yeah.
He's moving the weight that Austin's moving with one arm.
Let's go. Squeeze. All the way. All the way. Come on. Let's go.
Yep.
Squeeze him out. Pass. Good.
Y'all go to like full range of motion failure?
Full range. Then We call it the what? The branches?
Yeah, we call them the branch reps.
Get those extra fibers popping, man. It's all those little fibers that you're not recruiting during like full rep. Now you're just trying to, whatever you can get out, those are getting those, recruiting all those extra stuff. So you're gonna grow. It looks like it's not new, doing nothing, but it's getting all the extra little stuff that you didn't get during the set.
It's got that pretty influencer stuff.
Doesn't have to be perfect. Just has to get it done. That's all. Motherfucker, breathe, baby, breathe like a bird, so today I'm-